Okay, Mama, the president, when in his speech on Sunday, he was very committed to having more government schools taking up the role of teaching students. Should private schools succumb, some of them succumb to COVID. I could see even talked about having more community schools and supporting more of the growing schools for public schools. But in this case, if government takes over the supporting of these students in its own schools, it means we leave the teachers in the former private schools that are closing jobless. Is there any plan for them in that regard?
Well, Ministry of Education has been implementing the policy of at least one government primary school per parish and at least one government secondary school per sub-county in line with the NRM manifesto 2016-2021. We have been doing this through a dual approach of constructing schools and grant aiding existing private community schools. We intend to continue with and even expedite this process. Our intention is to ensure that learners and parents who choose private schools do as an option and not because there is no government school near their home. As regards teachers, whenever we have grant-aided a community school, we have also given priority to teachers who are already in these schools when it comes to recruitment of staff. We shall continue with that policy. Regarding financial viability of this policy, government is committed to its responsibility of equitable provision of education to its citizens. This responsibility cannot be ceded to the private sector, which, however, plays a very important role, and we know it. And if they can continue, we appreciate it. If they can't, we hope the schools we have scattered across the country can take on the children, and the teachers will remain in these schools to teach those children.
Sure. Thank you. Among the other issue in regard to the same issue for government taking over in case private schools succumb to COVID, some of the private schools succumb to COVID, is there a financial, is this financially viable to the government? Is this financially viable looking at the resource constraints for the sector? Is it affordable to the government? Having more community schools, having grant aiding more schools, is this financially viable?
This financial year may be difficult, but whenever we take on community schools, we plan for doing that in that financial year. So it will, we will have to determine, first of all, how many schools will not be able to continue because of COVID-19, and we will plan accordingly.
Sure. Right, okay. Mama, the other question is that we've had a very long period of schools and universities closed. How can teaching and assessment of students online and e-learning be implemented effectively within the shortest time possible? Because we're asking universities to go online, because they may not easily reopen, but it doesn't look effective. Currently, there are only 14 universities which have gone online out of the 50 universities. Very few have gone online. Is this going to be effective?
We have tasked the National Council for Higher Education to work with universities to come up with a workable proposal for quality assured online learning that at the same time ensures equitable access for all. So we would like to know from the universities themselves how many of their students can access online learning before we can move ahead with the full online learning for all programs.
Okay. All right. Mama, before I leave COVID, I wanted to switch to other issues in education, but there are two issues in on COVID, which one includes the SOPs, the standard operating procedures. I know we were expecting them probably to come out today, especially that now we have schools have to plan and it's almost like 2 weeks left. And we thought we could have these SOPs. I don't know when you hope they will come out.
They'll come out probably tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, but very soon.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm still on last question on COVID. It's about international schools. The president seems to say international schools will work with the Ministry of Health to see if they can reopen. That wasn't quite clear. So will they open or not? We've had so many international schools asking, so do we open, do we keep closed?
Now, the international schools follow a school calendar of the international affiliates. They don't have similar calendar like ourselves. Their candidate groups do not correspond to the standard education cycles in Uganda. And international schools in Uganda will be allowed to reopen for their upcoming international school calendar. Our decision is also based on the understanding that their enrollment and class sizes are smaller and more manageable. The learners are also taken to schools by private means. However, they have to provide the Ministry of Education and Sports with their study programs, the numbers of learners in the school, and the measures put in place to implement the SOPs as provided by Ministry of Health. They will also be inspected before they are allowed to reopen. So that's how we think we can help them manage, really, but it will take being sure of what their programs are like and the numbers of children in their schools. And we would also like to hear from the parents of the children in those schools. When the parents don't feel comfortable to just sending all children to school, we respect that, and we would guide them to do homeschooling if they prefer. But that's the guideline we have for the international schools for now.
Sure. Thanks, Mama. Away from the COVID pandemic, Mama, Makere's main building got burnt last Sunday, and in the morning, it was good to see you on site. How far the investigations in this matter, and what are the initial plans of reconstructing the main building?
Well, what happened to Makerere, it was very sad indeed for all of us. At the moment, our main concern is determining the cause of that fire and ensuring that such a tragedy does not happen again. The police and other responsible government agencies are handling investigations, and I'm sure they will issue a statement about the progress of the investigation at the right time. But I want to say that our hope and prayer is that we will be able, as a nation, to quickly rebuild that structure at Makerere as soon as possible.
Thank you, ma'am. Mama, I also understand there was a committee, a government committee, a cabinet committee that was constituted that came up with a white paper. And there were so many queries in regard to Makerere University. What is the Education Ministry's starting point in resolving these matters? Because there were a number of issues that show that Makerere has serious problems to sort out.
Yeah, a white paper on education is a comprehensive document covering all aspects and levels of education in Uganda. even tertiary education level. The white paper addresses issues of all public universities, not just Makerere. However, in regard to challenges at Makerere University, the Rwenda-Ire visitation report recommendations are being reviewed for implementation. As a ministry, we shall review the recommendation of the White Paper on Education Committee in line with countries' strategic education interests before determining which ones will be prioritized for implementation.
Thank you, Mama. Mama, New Vision, actually a vision group because of its other sister establishments, conducted a poll around the entire country in some districts, actually in some districts, but obviously that represent the entire country, Mama, in what we call the Citizens Manifesto. We asked the voters that voted in the NRM government 5 years ago, now what are their concerns for any other government they would want to vote into power? And then we asked them the concerns that they have, and education came top number three of the issues they feel are very important to them in their lives. And education sector, they mentioned things that trouble them. And among them was the high tuition, the poor quality of education, limited secondary schools, and unqualified and few teachers. Mama, what is your response in regard to these issues?
We will need an independent, comprehensive presentation as a response, especially given that the government is doing a lot to address these and other challenges in the education sector. Nevertheless, I will highlight some of the interventions we are undertaking in this direction. One, establishment of at least one government secondary school, as I had said before, per sub-county, through grant aiding and construction of seed schools. And I want you to note that it is the numbers in schools that make learning very difficult, and teachers handling so many children in one class. So trying to scatter these secondary schools in every sub-county will bring the numbers down, and teachers will then manage children at an individual level. But for now, it's a challenge to have a group of 70, 50, 60 children in one class and one teacher makes learning a challenge. Both for the teacher and for the learner. So, establishing this one secondary school in every sub-county will bring the numbers down. And then the primary, having a primary school at each parish, as we move forward, we think will change the quality of education also. Reforming the lower secondary education curriculum to improve relevance, quality, and efficiency of education delivery will also certainly bring in a lot of change. We are looking at development and approval of national teacher policy, which was approved to improve professionalism and effectiveness of the teaching service. That too will bring in motivation among the teachers, and teaching will be interesting for them, and learning will be easy for the learners. We have had a program that is called the Uganda Teacher and School Effective Project, which helped with the building of these schools and rehabilitating the old ones in this year and the last year, and that has improved schools a lot and provided more new schools in remote areas of the country. And we're scaling up early grade reading. This is ensuring that children at an early stage, primary 1 to primary 3, learn in their mother tongue And that is helping so much the children to grasp learning quickly at that early age, so that as they change into English, they already know what they are doing at school. Because starting in from the word go, learning in a foreign language was making it difficult for children to really get a grasp of learning. And there is another program that is strengthening education systems for improved learning that is going on through the Ministry of Education also at this moment. And then there is another program that is expanding the secondary education project in coming on board soon, just to provide more schools. All these programs will help to really change the quality of education in the country.
Sure.
And to make children get interested in being at school and learning, and so we think that the public may not know what has been happening in this year or the year before that is changing education as we move forward, but we are confident that it is happening, and they see it as it happens.
Mm. Thank you, Mama. Mama, over years, New Vision has been ranking schools when the national examinations get back. And it's just not about ranking, but when you consider the performance in some of the traditional public schools and our old schools in the country, you realize that it is always the private schools that get to perform better. Most of the time, if you look at top 100, you might find only like 20 or 30 public traditional schools. Then the question would be, what is it that is wrong with these public schools? Isn't it time we set performance targets for the people who run these schools, the head teachers?
Mm.
Shouldn't we have performance targets? Because that was an idea that was floated by the Minister of Education some time back. I don't know where that ended.
Well, the Ministry of Education is implementing a number of interventions, as I said. One approach is to improve effectiveness of school management. We know that effective head teachers are very critical in improving school performance, and performance contracts can play some role in promoting that. In this regard, the ministry developed and disseminated performance management guidelines to schools and tertiary institutions. These guidelines provide for signing of annual performance agreements for heads of schools and tertiary institutions to hold them accountable. However, we are taking a more holistic approach to improving school management, including strengthening the system of identifying, training, mentoring, and supporting quality school managers. With the Uganda Teacher and School Effectiveness Project, which I just talked about, we have been growing the capacity of school managers, and by effectively implementing the recently approved National Teacher Policy, which I also talked about earlier on, we shall be able to improve the quality of school management. We are hoping that will change.
Sure. Mm. Mama, I wanted, we're also concerned about the budget or plans the Education Ministry has in regard to hiring more science teachers, since many public schools are still struggling with the low staffing of science teachers.
Mm. Well, The Ministry of Education and Sports has for some time now been prioritizing recruitment of science teachers to fill the identified gaps. In order recruitment of secondary school teachers, we take affirmative action for science teachers. Currently, recruitment of additional 1,085 education officers, science included, is ongoing.
Wow. That's encouraging. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, ma'am. Mm-hmm. And then also, the other question is about there being calls from analysts and sports commentators, which we felt we needed to bring to your attention, of the need to give the sports subsector autonomy. From it's quite embarrassing that I'm asking you to relieve sort of one of your sectors.
Yeah.
But I had wanted to just bring the concerns of the Wana Inchi.
Mm.
They say that because they think when it is separate, it will get a bigger vote from the central government. I do not know what you have to say. Sorry, I had to ask that.
No, it's okay. So, if people are concerned with it, it's okay to open up and ask.
Thank you, ma'am.
Question.
Thank you.
But we think that that sports being part of education is a natural progression, so to speak, because the children from schools are the nursery of those sportsmen and women that you see when they have matured.
Sure.
But before that, they are being trained in schools. So when you separate them, it's like trying to keep to plant trees and you don't have a nursery.
Sure.
So I believe that it is important for these two to continue together, because most of the our young talents who have been breaking international sporting records have been nurtured through the education system. If we delink the two, we might cause a major gap and derail the development of sports in the country.
Sure.
Mama, I think it is good for sports to remain with its mother ministry.
We will sure give them your feedback on that.
Yes, okay.
Mama, you forgive me, there is a question I skipped. My sincere apologies. That has to do with Uganda National Examinations. Because now it calls for registration, so we don't know when the national examinations will be, and then maybe the registration in that regard.
I think I'll ask Mr. Dong to answer that question since he's here.
Oh, thank you, Mama. We were waiting for the Ministry of Education and Sports to come up with the revised school calendar. And Conan, you may be aware that the examination is a process that takes place within the school calendar. And so we have proposed that if schools reopen on the 15th of October, immediately would start the process of registration of the candidates. We are finalizing the software that they need, and by the time they go back to school, they should be able to start the registration process. That is the most important, because that's a source of data which informs the planning for all other activities for the examination. So we expect, God willing, that will take us about 5 weeks from about the 16th of October, and by middle of November, hopefully the registration process should be complete. Thereafter, there will be the internal activities of UNEP, That would include the printing of the exam papers themselves and several other activities that take place. We expect to begin to administer the Uganda Certificate of Education on the 1st of March. That examination normally takes a whole month plus. We expect to then administer the PLE on the 30th and 31st of March. And then we have the Easter period. So that will push the start of the Uganda Advanced Certificate of Education examinations a little bit. And we expect to start on the 12th of April. And that should end by the end of the calendar year, I mean the school calendar that the Honorable Minister, as Mama has said, that the calendar year will go up to the end of April. So we expect to end the Uganda Advanced Certificate of Education by the end of April. Then we go into the other processes of marking and so on. So that's how we have planned to fit within the revised school calendar. Thank you, Mama.
Thank you so much, Mr. Dom. Thank you, Mama, for allowing him to answer that. He would never have answered it outside this room without your permission. But Mama, and I think unless there is any question for my editor-in-chief, I'm going to let her ask. But I need to thank you for having given us this opportunity to re-answer these questions and giving us this time. I appreciate and thank you so much, and for your service to the sector and the country. Thank you, Mama.
It is a pleasure and honor. And we appreciate you because you take a lot of trouble to really get informed information that you give to the public from time to time through New Vision. So we appreciate you very much, and we would like to give you information whenever you need it so that people get real information rather than getting rumors and getting false information that they go out and talk about and bring anxiety to the families. So it's a real pleasure for us to talk to you and give you the information we have when we have it. When we don't have it, it's also okay to communicate that to you so that you don't pass out any information that is not real.